very good morning. In the prior lecture of history, chapter number 6, till the prior lectures, we got to know what was the effect of import of things from England on weavers and factory owners. Now, the only point remaining in this chapter to be discussed is what was the effect on the iron smelters. To know this, first let's know about the story of a ruler named Tipu Sultan of Mysore. Tipu Sultan was never in the favor of Britishers. He fought 4 wars with them and died while fighting against the British only. And while fighting, or while he died also, it is said that he died with his sword in his hand. Now, the very famous story, or like, the part of his fighting spirit was related to a very unique object he had, was his sword. You must be thinking, why is ma'am speaking about swords and all when we are talking about iron smelters? Now, this person had such a good sword with him, which could cut through even armors. Armors are held in hand to protect yourself, and they made with tough material as well. That particular sword could cut through armors also. So what made it that strong is the question. The answer to this question is that particular sword was made of a material called woods. It was made of a high carbon steel, and the name of the material given over there was woods. How did they make it? There was a process related to smelting. Smelting is a process where the metal is extracted from the ore by heating and melting the ore and then extracting the metal out of it at a particular temperature. Now, this sword was not only made out of woods, it had a flowing water kind of a pattern on the edge of the sword, which made it so strong that it could cut through armors. It was very thin at the end, but it has a wavy kind of a pattern at the end, which would help it to cut through armors. Human beings were like not even to be considered as well. So how did they make this kind of material is the question. As I said, it was made by the process of smelting. There were smelters at that time who used to extract the ore first and then make the sword. How did they do it is the question. Now, they had furnaces. Furnaces matlab bhattiyan hoti hain. Okay. Now, what they used to do it in a clay pot, in a pot of clay, they used to put charcoal and iron. Fine. And then at a particular temperature, they would make it reach and then melt it. That temperature was controlled, well defined and controlled. Only the smelters knew how it could be done. After they did it, when they smelted that thing, they got oblong shape. They used to make oblong shape blocks of steel out of it. So the material which came out was, they used to make blocks of steel, and then from that they used to make these woods, where the material was called woods. Now, not only in Mysore was this made. The smelters used to supply them to western side of India also, as well as Central Asia also. These swords used to be supplied. Now, this kind of when you talk about woods, what was it known in the local languages is also a good question. Now, the 3 names which have been given in the textbook, which tell you in different South India only, what were they called in different languages? First one was Ukku in Kannad. Second one was Hukku in Tamil and Telugu both, because mostly we say that Tamil and Telugu are relatively close languages. Like you know Tamil, like people say are of your opinion that if you know Telugu, you know Tamil as well. Hukku was the steel which was called in these 2 languages, and it was called Uruku in Malayalam. All 3 meant steel only. local language you could call them Maldis. They would call them Maldis names. Now this steel was so fascinating. This material was so fascinating. Like the study of the properties of chemical properties and physical properties of metal come under the category of domain of science, metallurgy. So one very famous scientist, Michael Faraday, had come to India to study about this particular wood steel. He wanted to know more about it. So he came and 4 years he spent over here studying what kind of metal is being made, what are the properties, that what would be the melting point and what technicalities of all the entire thing. But this kind of steel also had come to a standstill. The smelters lost their jobs. The production came to an end by the 19th century. Why? Because same reason why the weavers and the factory owners suffered. There was an import of iron and steel from England. When iron and steel started getting imported in our country from England, then these people, their entire work came to a standstill. And such a powerful metal, we lost control over the production of it, where smelters had suffered. Well, the import of iron and steel from England was not the only problem which actually declined the industry of iron smelting, not the industry, the process of iron smelting. By the 19th century, iron smelting had become very common. Firstly, when something is exquisite, it has value. When it becomes common, it loses its value. So, Bihar and Central Asia, wherever these iron ores were available, people used to extract ores and they started making furnaces, like they had established furnaces. And they started working on it at a very high rate. So many people were doing this smelting job. So there were many smelters in the country at that time, because it had become common, as I said. Now they had made a furnace. They had made furnaces made out of clay and sun-dried bricks. Now if you have seen any smelter working, in olden days they used to firstly make this metal and then heat it up and then give it this desired shape, whatever we wanted. Now to heat that particular metal, you needed wood. You needed access to the forest. You remember in the prior lectures I had said that British government had stopped the usage of forest reserves and they had taken the forest in their control. So the commoners couldn't go into the forest and barge into the forest and cut wood and come back. So that was not allowed by the Britishers. So the basic material which was required to smelt, for the smelting process, there was no access for the smelters to go and bring the firewood from the forest. That was one of the problems. Now, after that, taxes were to be paid very high. The amount of taxes which the smelters were paying reduced their profits. Now, if there is no profit, nobody would like to do that job. Moreover, it required a lot of strength and energy. Like the process involved, the smelting process was done by the men and there was an instrument called bellow. Now, bellow is a sack kind of a thing which you need to keep pressing by your leg to pump air. So, that process was done by the women of the family and that would exhale air, that they would emit air that would keep the charcoal burning, and that's how the metal would be extracted from the ore, because that particular temperature would be maintained. Now, because of so much of hard work also, high taxes also, non-availability of resources also, strict forest laws also, this entire process had become not such a good way of earning your livelihood. So people started quitting, the smelters started quitting on this particular art and they opted for some other livelihoods, like the others also did in earlier part of what we had discussed. They also started taking up other livelihoods for earning their living. well, so it was not only these, one more great factor, like one more prominent factor affected the iron smelting smelters. Let's see what it is. Well, by 1904, two people had wanted to go and explore which were the best iron ore deposits, where were they located in India. These two were an American geologist, Charles Weld, and the son of Jamshedji Tata, Zorabji Tata. So these two people got onto the quest of finding out where are the iron ores, because Jamshedji Tata wanted to establish an iron steel industry in India, and he was ready to spend a fortune on it. They were rich people, so they were ready to invest a lot in this industry, but they wanted to know firstly from where could they procure their raw material. So he had sent his son and this geologist in the search of the best iron ore available in India. Their search led them to a place called Chhattisgarh. Now Chhattisgarh was supposed to have the best iron ore deposits. They kept searching and searching, but they couldn't find the best source of it. Until they, while they were searching for it, they reached a place where they saw people bringing iron ore extracted from a hill. And those were the people whose names were Agarias. Now these Agarias, when questioned by these two, they told them that we have brought this particular iron ore from a nearby place, and the place's name was Rajhara Hills. Now when the geologists reached over there with great difficulty, there was a trek, and very difficult trek from, like, amidst the forest you had to move, and then you had to cross the forest and go to the hills. But that was a very good find for them. These hills, when the geologist reached, he declared over there, this is the best possible iron ore you can ever find. But how to set up an industry, because this area was dry, and wherever an industry is set up, you need a water source over there. So the problem arose as to how do we set up an industry just beside these hills, because there was no source of water. So they decided to make an industrial township in Jamshedpur, and the steel plant which was established was the Bhilai steel plant. So that particular place was established, and then the production of iron and steel started over there, and no problem of water arose over there, and they came in TISCO, Tata Iron and Steel Company. In 1912 it was established. Now the Tatas started building a very good quality of steel, and the Britishers themselves were awestruck that the Indians themselves were producing such high quality of steel, apart from what was being imported from England. Now in 1914, when the First World War broke, the same effect what it had on the cotton industry, if you remember, that Britishers started buying from us only, from our industries only, the same effect came on the iron and steel industry in India as well. When the World War broke, the Britishers needed more and more iron and steel, and then it couldn't import. It had stopped importing that particular metal from England, because they themselves needed it. So when the import stopped, the demand for the iron and steel rose in our country, and the Britishers themselves bought 90% of the produced steel from Tatas during that particular time. Now if you had noticed, like, only and only these industries could prosper in the industrialization in the industrial revolution. These industries in India could only prosper when the First World War broke and the imports reduced. The import of cotton textiles, the import of steel reduced. Then only Indian industries could emerge and they could prosper. So that particular era played a major role in helping the Indian industries during the Industrial Revolution to prosper. So we have come to an end of the chapter. So there are questions given over there, short questions also and long questions also. I'll be making you mark certain things. Go through your chapter very well. Read each and every point, which is very, very important, especially the keywords. You know, the definitions have been given on either side of the page. But read them properly, understand the concept, you know where which particular answer would be. Be ready for a test as well. Now that I have finished this particular chapter, I will be taking a test on it. Thank you.